circuit world. Now the room seems coming to an end.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to episode 42 of the Caribbean Cricket Podcast. I am your co-host, Machel St. Patrick Hewitt, and you know who's with me.
Yes, Santokie here. Good day to everyone tuning in. Hope you're all good. And Machel, today is a very special episode for many reasons, one of which is we finally got a guest after 1 year. We finally got a guest who's a fellow Spurs fan. For those of you who don't know Tottenham, that's the mighty Tottenham. I've been waiting for this moment. So it's a good start for me, Machel. But yeah, no, we've got a guest on who's people that tune into us will know we have the utmost respect for him in terms of what he's done for West Indies cricket and what he currently does at the moment in his role. So, Machel, without further ado, do you want to introduce our guest to the people?
Of course I do. Who would have thought that when we started this podcast, about a year and a half ago, Santokie, that we'd be in this position now where we can welcome on Uncle Phil, the head coach of the West Indies cricket team. For those listening and those watching, you can either hear him or see him in the background already laughing. But yes, indeed, we've got Phil Simmons on. Both of us are absolutely honoured to have Phil on. Not only, of course, is he the head coach of the West Indies team, but Santokie, he's the head coach of the 2021 unbeaten West Indies test team.
Undefeated after four tests. Yeah, so long may that run continue.
Phil, how you doing?
I'm good. How's things?
They're good, you know. They're good this side. In fact, actually, I say this side. Are you in England, Phil?
Yes, I'm in London.
Yes, I thought as much. Yeah. So I'm saying good this side, like you're across the world somewhere when you're probably just around the corner from us as well.
Yeah, and I heard you earlier say Craig and them are up here, so I was wondering, you know.
So yeah, obviously you are here, and this is where you reside. But yeah, good to have you on, Phil, and we've got an absolutely bumper episode today. When we put out to the audience and the fans about getting you on, there were so many questions, it was a struggle just to know which questions to pick to put to you. But without any further ado, because if we don't start, this episode could run all night long. So Santokie, let's just jump straight into it. And Phil's no different. Yes, he might be the head coach of the West Indies, but Phil had a career himself, and yeah, a very good career at that. So let's jump into Phil's career.
Yeah, so something we ask all guests, Phil, is how did you get into cricket growing up in Trinidad? Who were your early influences? And at what point did you decide cricket is something I can do as a career?
I got into cricket from early. I think one of the good things about Caribbean and especially Trinidad, we play, I don't know if it still goes on now, but I was introduced to cricket at about 9, 10 in primary school. And my standard five teacher, Mr. Lewis, he made sure that we went out and we played cricket in PE periods. And that's where my love and my enjoyment of the game started from. So the younger you get into it, the easier it is to fall in love with it. And I think that's been the start. And it to this stage now, I always remember that day, the first few days we went out and we played it, you know, in the schoolyard. No pitch, no anything. It's just the schoolyard and put up a cricket tin and we played. So that was where things started.
And am I right in saying that in your early days playing in Trinidad, Rohan Kanai was one of your early coaches?
Yeah, I played for East in zonal competition. And I was, I think, 18 years, just gone to under 19 with West Indies. And he came to coach the East Zone. And he spent a few years there. And he was a huge influence on my career at that time. The way he started to teach us to think about practicing and the way we were playing the game, the fitness side of the game and all that he brought to the zone. It was sad that Trinidad and Tobago didn't keep him as their head coach. He went on to Jamaica and he did a lot for Jamaica's cricket in that time.
Very interesting. And so at that point, you played for, I think, Trinidad and Tobago. You made your debut in, was it 1983, around that time? How did you find the adjustment moving into first-class cricket? Was it hard to sort of step up from club cricket to the first-class setup?
No, I think back at that time, it wasn't that hard because the quality of the club cricket was hard. And especially I played most of my club cricket with Crompton CC in the Savannah, and playing cricket in the Savannah and matching wickets was a test in itself, and it built a lot of character among players who played at that time on matching wickets. And so it helped the fact that I was playing at first division for Crompton, and we were playing against all the Trinidad players every weekend. You're playing against some Trinidad players, so that helped a lot. So the transition was not that difficult.
Yeah, and we've mentioned Rohan Kanai in that Trinidad and Tobago side when you were coming through in the early 80s. Who were sort of teammates who sort of helped you out and who you thought were influential?
When I started, you had opening panels Richard Gabriel, who at the time was one of the top openers Trinidad had produced. Larry Gomes, although he wasn't there much, he was with West Indies a lot, but Larry Gomes was in the team. Sheldon Gomes, you know, that's when I started. That's the kind of people that were in that squad.
And so from that point, I think it was 1987, you made your debut for West Indies in an ODI. Machel, do you want to talk about West Indies now?
Yeah, and it's interesting, Phil, because I always joke and say that when I first properly got into West Indies cricket, it was in the mid to tail end of the 90s. So I always say that when my father passed down the oral tradition of following West Indies, and obviously you become an obsessed West Indian, I started to follow as the beginning of the decline started, so to speak. But you were in that team, like you were in the summer decline team. We were still good, but you were in the team that was still winning before the decline came. And when I kind of track your career with the West Indies, I always found it quite strange, because what did you think was your best position or role in the side, whether test or ODI? Because I always saw you as a bit of a floating player. Would that be harsh to say or wrong to say?
Well, I don't know. I don't know exactly what you mean by floating, but the way I saw it at that time, I was aggressive. I wanted to go there, and as we say that in those days, beat ball, I was like looking at the way Gordon and Desmond played. And you wanted to keep up that sort of tradition, because they put a lot of pressure back on bowlers because of their aggressiveness when they were batting. So you always want to be like that. And then the master, you came in at a time when the master was the master. So you've seen him playing, and you're trying to think, well, look, you've got to make sure that you're keeping up the standards here.
And I mean, you played for the West Indies all the way up until just shy of 2000. I think your last game would have been like 98, 99. So what would you say, based on your career in the Maroon, what would you say was the turning point to when, and again, I've referenced kind of like the beginning of the end, as a player who kind of traversed both eras? So you started when we were still beating everybody, and as you left the side, we were just starting to get beaten. What was the key difference from your perspective as a player across both eras of that side?
I wish I could put my finger on that, because I would have tried to change things a long time ago. It's difficult to say where the transition took place from us dominating to us starting to be dominated. It's difficult to put your finger on that. I think there's a lot of different factors. I think one of the things is, I'm trying to remember now how many of the senior players left at the same time. So it was not always, we didn't have enough other guys in that transition who stayed on and pushed the young fellas to understand what they were doing before and to, so that we could continue that legacy. So I think even now, I don't think we understand as players now understand that legacy and what that meant for West Indians all over the world, not just cricket fans, just West Indians all over the world.
Mm. And I mean, let's not downplay. Let's not try and downplay your career with the West Indies. You had some significant highlights, and actually, Santokie, I think we had, was it Osman? When we put the questions out, I think Osman came to us from ESPN and said, "Please talk to Phil." What was it against Pakistan, Santokie?
Yeah, Phil, you probably might have been expecting this to come up, but against Pakistan, Benson and Hedges, 1992, still to this day, the record most economical spell in an ODI. I'll just read it out, the stats out here, they're amazing. 10 overs, 8 maidens, Machel, 3 runs conceded and 4 wickets. So Osman just wanted you to talk through this spell, exactly what went right for you on that day. Don't forget, Pakistan were the world champions at that point as well.
Look, all through that series, all through that tournament, I'd been bowling good. I got to the stage where the captain was happy enough to let me use a new ball with sometimes Patrick Patterson on the other end. So it was like, yeah, I'm bowling in tandem with Pato, you know, or with Walsh, whoever, Ambrose. But at the same time, because I was bowling so well, I got the new ball, and with in Australia and especially Sydney and Melbourne, the new ball was moving a lot. So I just been practicing what to do and just going out there and just trying to hit the right areas. And that night, not only that night, because I think I had an 3 for 16 against Australia. I think a week before that. So generally, I was bowling well throughout that tournament, and that night everything just clicked. You know, the prize wicket Javed meandered in Zuman ul Haq, you know, so it just clicked that night.
Phil, you were a talented all-rounder, obviously, and let's not discount, obviously, your ability in the field as well. What was your strongest suit from your own perspective? With the bat, the ball, in the field, you're going to say all of them, but what was... But what, as a on a personal level, what did you think you should have been recognised for? And like, so you look at like Jason Holder as an all-rounder today, and people argue about whether he's better with the bat, the ball, whatever it might be. But what, as a fellow all-rounder, what did you think your strength was?
No, I think my strength was with the bat. I bowled in limited over cricket. I bowled a lot more in Test cricket. I didn't bowl much. But my role and my significant role was with the bat. So I think the bat will be up front at all times.
Mm.
And who would you say was the toughest bowler you faced as a batsman on the international scene?
Other than our bowlers, Wazim Akram by a mile. By a mile. You know, Wazim was so quick and he can do anything he wanted with that ball. So Wazim.
Okay, good shout. And as a bowler, who was a batsman who you thought, this is gonna be a tough day?
I think in that time, the few times that I bowled to Sachin, it was as wide a bat as I've seen, you know. I mean, there were a lot of great cricketers in that time, but I think Sachin was a different story, you know.
Phil, you play, I feel like, do you know what? I feel like you're understating your career, you know. So you played with distinction in county cricket as well. For Durham and Leicestershire. And in fact, I think in 97, you were one of the Wisden Cricketers of the Year because of your role with Leicestershire.
96,
sorry. And the reason I bring that up is because I think, like we said, off air before we started, we spoke about how Kimar is currently here, Craig Brathwaite's here, Alzari Joseph is here. Now, as a former West Indian who international who played in county cricket. What do you see, or whether it's when you were there or current, how do you see county cricket and its role, whether back then or today? Because to be honest, seeing Craig and Kumar and Alzari here was refreshing, because we haven't had enough West Indians come and play county cricket over the last, let's say, 10 years. Wow. Maybe that's too long. Maybe I should say 5 or 6 years. But what do you see as the role of county cricket?
I think when we came over here to play, a lot of it was about responsibility, professionalism, because when you come over as an overseas player, there's a lot of responsibility on you to carry the team, to be the one to guide the team. So I think that was a major part of it, because that helped when you went back home and you had that responsibility in the middle and you have to do the job here for this team. You gained a lot of respect for the fact that you can make decisions by yourself out in the middle. And that came from coming up here and being out there, even in the leagues, not just in county cricket, in the leagues. When guys came up in the league, they had to control everything for that team they were playing for. So it improved your character, it improved your leadership ability and everything like that. And I think that is something that we would look for then. And now it's been a long time, as you say. I can't tell you exactly how long that we've had players playing for the county, but I think that's just a fact of the time period we play our international cricket in now. Because if once IPL had finished the end of May, we are going into the series against Australia and Pakistan. So a lot of guys would not be able to play the whole county season. So that's why we've struggled for a number of years.
And I mean, Given you're here, are you watching closely? Are you able to watch closely to see, particularly, I'm going to pick out Alzari more than Kumar and Craig. Kumar and Craig are experienced, established West Indian internationals. Alzari's still making his way. Are you trying to catch as much of them as you can here and there?
Well, because of the whole situation, you can't really go and watch the games. But you look at the highlights and a few games. I know Craig and them were on TV live, because no IPL, they were on TV live. I didn't get a chance to see it, but you know, it's good. And I'm glad you talk about Azari, because I think the other two, the experience is there, but I think this would be a great booster for Azari and his bowling, especially. His batting has been coming along fine, but his bowling would get a huge lift from this little stint here.
Most definitely. And I think when Santokie and I, in talking about it, when we saw he got the deal at Worcestershire, that's exactly what we said, that it was the best thing for him at this juncture. And obviously with South Africa coming, test series, so on and so forth. But obviously we've spoken about your career, and then when your career draws to an end, you get into coaching. And when we talk about Phil Simmons, you speak to the average cricket fan, they'll see you as a coach first and foremost. Whether that be for your stint with Ireland, whether that be for Afghanistan and obviously currently West Indies. But how did you make the transition? Was it something you always wanted to do? Or what made you want to jump into coaching?
I think when you look at things and then you keep looking around, coaches are formed from your playing days. I think you have guys sometimes in a dressing room who sharers, givers, and they become good coaches, they become good educators, whereas you have guys who, you know, make sure that they are well looked after. Then when you're going into coaching time, it's hard for them. And I think halfway through my first year at Leicester, a good friend of mine, Tim Boone, he was the opener with Leicester, but he was also one of the coaches with the ECB. The coaching system had just started, and he just told me, I'm going to set up that you do your coaching courses, because when you finish this, I can see you being a coach. And I didn't take too much to what he was saying. But then come 98, and he guaranteed that I would go on the level 3 course. And when I finished that, then it started to hit me, and I started doing things, small jobs here, in winter, in with some friends, and started to enjoy it. So it just moved from 1 to 2 to 3, and now to where I am now.
Santokie, did you want to jump in?
Yeah, and I think there's a common thread with the sides you've coached on, for instance, Ireland, Afghanistan, and West Indies to an extent as well. They're not able to compete on the same financial level. They're under-resourced when compared to other major cricketing nations, but you've managed to improve them all in different ways, despite them being very different culturally, geographically. What are sort of your keys to coaching success? Do you have some fundamental principles that you apply as a coach, regardless of the team?
I think the first fundamental as a coach is to get to understand your players, get to know your players, and know how you have to inveigle them, how you have to convince them, lift them, how you have to get them to perform. And I think that's the biggest thing in the coaching, other than the technical things where you change a guy from A to B, you know, how you hold a bat, how you play shots, but, you know, basic coaching. I think the other factor is how you get people to perform when they go to the middle. And I think that is the important part now at this level. And it has been, because with Ireland especially, there were a new country coming along, and we had to change a few things there in order for the guys to start looking at how at themselves and improving themselves and getting the confidence in themselves to play at that other level. Afghanistan, a little bit of the same, a lot of talent, a lot of young players coming through, a couple stars in Rashid and Nabi. But again, they wanted to improve. They had to get that push and that understanding that this is international cricket and this is the way. But I also had to understand, and I'm grateful for something that you mentioned. I'm so grateful for the different cultures that I've worked in, because I know home and I know how to deal with home. But when you go to Ireland, it was a big change. I did Zimbabwe too, so that was a huge change too. So it's great, the experience of these cultures and them, and then coming back home and working with my own.
And I think a common question we got on social media was about data analytics. Kind of how big does that play in your coaching method? And have you found it generally difficult or easy for players to kind of take in data analytics?
I think it's getting a lot easier now because the way it's put over and the understanding of how it's supposed to be used, and us as coaches and as analysts getting the players, finding a way to put it over to the players that they would want to use it and be happy to use it. I think it's a huge part of all sport. So it's great to see it evolving in cricket as much as it is.
And before Machel gets more in depth with your sort of West Indies stint as a coach, just out of interest, what would be, at Ireland, for instance, you were there for 8 years, what would be your personal highlight as Ireland coach?
I think the personal highlight would be all our performances at World Cups. Because when you go to World Cups, and I think the Irish people in themselves would be extremely, they would say that beating England in the World Cup was the biggest moment they've had in cricket, you know, because of that rivalry. But just in general, how we played in that World Cup, how we played in 2015 World Cup, where we beat West Indies, by the way. So, you know, but it's just the way we turned up for World Cups and the way that we played without that fear.
Yeah.
So, Phil, you're world renowned with what you did with Ireland, and then you get the West Indies job the first time round. And first, I'm going to speak as a fan first and foremost. When you got the job, I was excited. I was like, yes, finally, Phil has come home. Now it's time. Someone who's going to understand how to take us forward. And obviously, let's first and foremost deal with the high. World Cup winning coach 2016. So, and I think sometimes people may forget that you were actually the coach when we won the World Cup. But I'm trying to think how to phrase this. What's no, let me start again, Phil. Your first stint didn't go as planned. I'm just gonna be from my perspective, it didn't go as planned. I'm not saying there's anything to do with you. It didn't go as planned. But for you, what was the experience for you? Because the first time round, you were almost there with the start of a lot of the players who have played over the last 5 years. So the Jasons, the Rostons, the Shane Dowriches, etc., who all kind of made their transition then over the next 4 to 5 years. And you didn't get to see that through until obviously you've come back again. But how do you reflect on that first stint?
First of all, difficult. But as I do all the time, well, it's difficult. And I try and enjoy what I'm doing. And I think it was enjoyable because I was back home. I was working with West Indians rather than any other nation. And we had a little bit of success. I remember we drew the test series in the Caribbean with England. Went on a little bit later to win the World Cup. So we had a little bit of success, which is what you want when you start in something, so that people start buying into what you want to do. But it was a lot more disappointing than it was successful, because maybe the people who were there at the time, I don't know if they didn't want to see the cricket go forward or what was it, but the backing was not there.
With the team that you had then, would you say that, because like I say, I made particular reference to, because even Jermaine was with you the first time round, in fairness, Jermaine Blackwood. You had a very young team that first time round. Was it too young? Now, obviously, your experiences with Ireland, you'd already grown a team in the past in terms of Ireland, but can you have a side that's too young and too inexperienced, particularly at the test level? Because the only real experienced player we had, and obviously he then retired, was Shiv. We didn't really have anybody left within that kind of, in your first stint, who you could say you are really, really experienced at the top level of cricket. Or is that too harsh of a statement, or too narrow of a statement?
No, it's a true statement. You had a lot of youngsters, as you said. Dorridge, Chase, Blackwood, Jason was young then, coming into the team. But in teams that you look around the world, there's always the two or three, sometimes five or six, are the more experienced players you could have when younger players come into the team, the quicker the younger players grow. And I think that we were a young team then, and things had to be put in place in order for us to try and get better and try and move up the table. In the other formats, we had a lot of experience, so we could do better. We could have on the pitch a number of experienced players to help the two or three young players that were coming into those teams. But in the test team, we couldn't do that, so we had to try and build from scratch in the test team. And it would have taken a few years, as we've seen with all the youngsters, to grow and to be able to, you know, perform at the international level the way they wanted to do.
With the, you make reference to the experienced players, and obviously, again, we referenced the 2016 World Cup. Some of those players are still here now. So Pollard, Bravo, Gale, they're all still about, just to pick three. But when you had them in 2016, as a coach of what, I mean, even now, but even, sorry, even then, these were experienced franchise players, players who had played IPL over and over and over again. In 2016, as a coach, was it about, how hands-on were you? Or was it about assigning the role for a Chris Gayle, assigning a role, obviously Pollard wasn't there, but assigning a role for a Bravo and saying, you're experienced, you know what you're doing? Or how do you manage a team that has experience like that?
I think, as I said before, you have to understand your players. You have to know when to pull them up. You have to know if to pull them up at any time, or if they understand that we've played bad today, or we didn't do our best even though we won. And that's the thing when you have that full experience like we did then, because everyone was experienced. We missed Polly because of an injury, but everyone had that franchise experience that you're talking about. And so it wasn't about training anybody to play T20 cricket. In fact, I learned a lot from some of these guys, Bravo and Chris and them, because they had been in T20 cricket forever. So it was about trying to make sure that the way we did things when we practiced, the practice was purposeful, and the way we did it, the way we played our cricket, and to get players to understand that every day when we go on that field, we represent in West Indies and we want to win, because we had won 4 years before and we wanted to win again. And it was good that we still had Sammy as captain, and he led from the front in that tournament again as the tournament before. So, you know, it just, everyone just gelled, and I think it was more about getting the team to understand what we were there for. And I think it was summed up for me in the first day of practice, because we had a little camp in Dubai before we went on to India. And the first little huddle we had, and we were talking about it. And I remember Marlon Sudhapani, he just said, guys, we're here, let's go and take what's ours. And I'll never forget that little huddle, and that's how the whole practice, the first practice session we had, that's how it started. And we went on, and as he said, we took what was ours.
Well, you know there's another World Cup this year, though.
I know we're defending champions too.
But speaking of T20 franchise stars, so 5 years on now, and we're in 2021, and we have I wouldn't say a new batch, but certainly potential superstars in our wings again, in Nicholas Puran and Shimron Hetmyer in particular. And that's not to disregard someone like an Evan Lewis as well. But if we focus on a Puran and a Hetmyer, for example, who have the world at their feet, so to speak, as a coach, Phil, and maybe this is putting you on the spot a bit, their ability in short format cricket doesn't need any explanation, whether that's ODIs, whether that's T20s. How do we get them to play red ball? how are we going to get, as a Trini, Phil, how are we going to get Nicholas? How are we going to get red ball cricket? How is that possible when every franchise wants him?
Well, it's a difficult thing. It's a difficult thing for him, difficult thing for us. I think it's important to know that we're trying as CWI to make sure that things are open, and the players, we're not pigeonholing any players. We have everybody out there as international players, and it's going to get to the stage where Shimron, who has played, and he will get back into that frame of mind that he wants to play all formats. We have Nicholas, who hasn't played red ball yet, but played a couple of 18 games in New Zealand after the T20 series, and by every account, looked the part totally. So it's about the blend, and as we go along, how they blend into the squad that they're now, because we've had some youngsters come in and shown that they want to be there, and they want to control test cricket from a batting point of view. So it's about Shimron and Nicholas pushing their way into the squad, and that only happens with scores, with runs.
Santokie, was there a question on Shimron and Nicholas, or have I just
yeah, you asked pretty much. Yeah.
So in that case then, Shimron and Nicholas notwithstanding, Santokie, do you want to jump into, I said at the top about how we're undefeated in 2021. Do you want to jump into that?
Yeah, so I guess we're on a golden run in tests at the moment, undefeated in 2021. And also, as you said, we're defending champions in the T20 format. I guess for you personally, what would be your ambitions or next step for West Indies cricket, let's say, in the next 2 years? What would you define as a successful period, particularly in the test arena?
I think we're going to have a tough 6 test matches in the rest of this year. And my focus is in those 6 test matches to play the sort of cricket that we have to play in order to move up the ICC rankings. I think that we have the ability, we've shown that we have the ability, but the thought process must come with it. We've shown the thought process in Bangladesh. We've shown it here now in Antigua. And it's just about understanding how we evolve, how we improve. And South Africa is going to be a huge test for our test team. Mm. And when we come out of that, there's another huge test in Pakistan because they've been playing some brilliant international cricket over the past year also. So it's going to be tough. And then we go to Sri Lanka and it's always tough down there. So when we come out of this 6 test matches, we will know, and especially if you can still say undefeated in 2021, then we will know that we're going somewhere. So that's how we're looking at, but we take it one at a time. These two against South Africa is going to tell us a lot about ourselves and our players.
Would you say, sorry, Santokie, just jumping in, would you say, Phil, that this is the strong, it's so weird how this has come about and how cricket and sport can change in the blink of an eye, but we're now in a position where some players are on the outside looking in who currently can't get into the test team. So we spoke about Apuran, a Hetmeyer, Bravo's not in it, Chase isn't in it, Brooks is out at the moment. Would you say this is the, Hope's not in it, would you say that this is the strongest pool you have been able to work with across the two stints in? And when I say strongest, I mean potential in terms of, I feel like, again, I'm coming from a fan's perspective, I feel like we're developing a pool of players now as opposed to, well, that's the start in 11 and unless there's one or two changes, not a whole lot's really changing. Is that a right way to look at it, or how are you looking at it as a coach?
I think that's the correct way to look at it. I think you have a pool, and right now you have last test match, 4 batsmen played. I mean, 6, but the 2 openers and 4 batsmen. And you had another 4 or 5 batsmen, counting Shimron and Nicholas. You had 5 batsmen who could play in the middle there. Mm. So it makes the success majorly important for you who are in the team. And that is what is going to propel the team up by the fight for places and the players knowing that performance is what keeps you in that place. And the young guys who came in, they're realizing that performance is keeping them there and their performance has kept them there now. But also the guys you mentioned who are not in the squad, they know that anytime they get back in, they have to perform to stay there. So I think that's when you have a movement upwards, for want of a better phrase, because everybody knows that performance is what going to get them and keep them in the team. But we know as a coaching unit and think that performance is what's going to propel us upward. So it's a win-win situation for all of us.
With, sorry, Santokie, sorry, one more for me. With one player I just wanted to quickly point out, Phil, Jaden Seals, I think in the last, can't remember if it was Sri Lanka, I think it was, or was it away in Bangladesh? He's been tagging along almost like in a developmental role. What's your views on him as a young knight, as a 19 years old? But what do you see as his up or his potential at this particular juncture?
I think he has tremendous potential. I think he can be one of the greats with his ability and his pace and everything. It's something that we've started to do. I think Ireland series, Last Ireland series, we had O'Shane and Obed McCoy with the team, even though they weren't part of the team, so that we could work with them and get them to understand the feel of being among international players. We had it with Preston McSween and Aquino Minley. A few of them were in England, and then Preston and Jaden Seals were in New Zealand. And that's what we want to do. When we're around the Caribbean, we're trying to make sure we have the young fast bowlers especially with us. So it's good, but I think there's a few Seals and a few others who have shown that they are hungry to be in this test team especially. And that's a good thing, because Shannon Gabriel, Kimar, Azari, Jason, everyone knows that there's guys looking to push for places. So they've got to continue performing as they've done for over the last 5 or 6 years, because the bowling is what has carried this team for a while now.
Sorry, Santokie.
Yeah, I think one thing from fans and journalists we've heard over the years is domestic cricket in West Indies is on a steady decline. Obviously, in the past year, we've seen particularly batsmen, Josh De Silva, Carl Mayers, Bonar, Jermaine Blackwood go back and get runs at domestic level. And all of them make a transition to test cricket, Bonar, Silva, Mayers, with relative ease from an outsider's point of view. Do you think that's reflective of an improving domestic structure, or is there anything you would like to see changed within domestic cricket in the West Indies?
I think it shows a little bit of an attitude change. But again, the quality is going to be defined by the mental attitude of the players at franchise level. Because if I'm playing any cricket and that sense of pride that in my performance is not there, then the standards are not going to be high. If we get all these players, and I hope players are looking and saying, but Blackwood scored, Miles scored, they got their chance, so let me try and score the 700 or 800 that they scored and see if I can get my chance then. And that's the only way the cricket is going to start going up. What you call him, Shamar Holder, got wickets and he got his chance. He played a test match in New Zealand. So the standard has to go up and keep going up, because we always say, and I hate going back to days before, but domestic cricket, 4-day cricket between islands was test matches back in the day. So we needed to get to that stage where everybody is coming at each other. Even though I'm playing with you next week in the test team, this week I want to take your head off. I want to make 100 or 200 against you. So that's when everything will start going back up.
I have, as Phil was talking earlier on, and even now, Santokie, I just had like a light bulb moment, and you're going to thank me for this. So, Phil, Santokie, when it comes to CPL, Santokie is a Guyana Amazon Warriors fan. He's of Guyanese extract. Now, Guyana, Phil, have never won CPL, and they choke every single year. But you've won CPL, Phil. Maybe Santokie. Maybe it's that you need Phil to coach Guyana.
You know what, Machel? As soon as you mentioned Guyana, I could see Phil just laughing. He knew where it was going.
You never know these days, you see? You never know.
But do you know why I brought it up though, Phil? Because obviously in 2019, you won CPL with the Tridents. And just touching on that very briefly, what was the key to... I'm taking the mick out of Santokie, but he actually needs to hear this answer. What was the key to being a successful CPL franchise?
To me, the franchise cricket is getting people to play with one another, to see the direction of where the franchise wants to go in that tournament, and everybody line up to go in that direction. With international grid, you have more time to put it together. And franchise, you got to get everybody understanding as soon as you come in. This is the way we want to go. This is how we're going to win this tournament. And let's start doing the things that we've got to do to win this tournament. And if everybody buys into it early enough, then you have a chance.
Santokie, did you hear that? But do you know what, Phil? With every guest that we have, we always when we near the end, and thank you, by the way, for I reiterate again, thank you for coming on and being so honest in your responses and answering the supporters and the fans' questions as well. But I'm gonna shoot to the question, Santokie. You cool with that, yeah?
Yeah, if you're ready, Machel, a big question.
So every time we get a guest on, Phil, we ask them a series of questions as we come towards the end. And you're no different, head coach or not. So question number one, Phil. What is your favourite ground, obviously in your capacity as coach now, what's your favourite ground to coach the West Indies at or play at, whatever you want to say, other than the only ground you can't say is Queen's Park Oval? What's your favourite ground in the Caribbean?
Favorite ground in the Caribbean?
Yeah.
My favorite ground in the Caribbean would be St. Kitts.
Interesting. Why St. Kitts?
Well, I just think that there's a atmosphere there. When people are in, when we get back to that stage, there's a nice atmosphere in St. Kitts. The ground is small, good wicket, everything like that. So I think quite a few of the guys, not so much of the bowlers, but quite a few of the batsmen love playing there.
And when you were playing, and I'm going to say outside the Caribbean now, what was your favorite ground, or your favorite? What was your, do I want to say your best experience? What was your favorite ground to play in as a player?
My favorite ground was the MCG. I think that's the. Well, at least when I played, that was the best ground in the world. You know, I have all respect for the traditions of Lords and what it brings when you play there and everything. But for me, I love the MCG.
Excellent. And you know what, Santokie, one more question came into my head as Phil was saying that. So Phil played with some of the most iconic players in West Indies cricket history. And then as you would have been growing up, you would have watched some of the most iconic players in West Indies history. So this is a hard one, you know, Phil. You might lose friendships after you answer this one. Who is the best West Indian player you have either seen or played with? Think carefully before you answer this, Phil. You played with at least two of the big greats. In fact, more than two. What am I talking about? You played with so many greats. Never mind what so many greats. Who's the best that you've seen?
The three best that I have seen or played with, I didn't see. I'm talking about live now. I didn't see Sir Gary Sobers. But the two best, three best I've played with is. Viv Richards, Brian Lara. So Viv Richards, Brian Lara, and the best bowler I've played with is Malcolm Marshall. As the three best cricketers I've played with in West Indies.
But now pick one. we're not going to be cruel.
That's why I gave you three.
Yeah, we won't go any further. But you know what, Phil? As you said, with the remainder of this year, obviously we've got South Africa on the horizon. Then the Aussies come in, and obviously Pakistan. And as Santokie kind of alluded to, I kind of feel like, and I'm kind of going to come back to you, Phil, to kind of wrap it up for us. But I kind of feel like we passed the Bangladesh test. We've passed the Sri Lanka test, and these are teams for me who, if we are to improve, we had to be strong against. And what's interesting about South Africa and Pakistan now, more so than Australia, is they're what I call the next two on the rung. above if we're to make those transitions. You've kind of alluded to it, Phil, but do you see it like that as well, that these are realistic tests for the West Indies as opposed to playing a New Zealand away or an England away, etc.?
I think these are two teams that are quality test teams. I'm not saying that the two series we play were not quality, but they're higher up the table than the two we've played. So to be high up on the table on the ICC table, you have to be playing good test cricket for a period of time in order for you to get up there. And these two, the next two series we have are teams that have done that. So it is going to be a challenge, but we're going to see the character of the players that we have now. And we're going to see how much that character has been built up over the last 6 or 8 months through COVID, and now to almost getting back to just getting people watching again. So it's something that we are looking forward as coaches to see where that character is going now.
Most definitely. And as fans, we're super excited to see it. Santokie, I'm going to hand over to you to bring it to a close.
Yeah, I guess actually it's only right. I mentioned it at the top of the show, Phil, you're a big Spurs fan. So it's only right I ask you, all-time favourite Spurs player.
All-time favourite Spurs player.
Yeah.
I must say one thing, though. I went off a little bit, but I came back when they sacked that last manager. So, my all-time favourite, I have two. My top two Spurs player of all time, number one was Glenn Hoddle. Got me into it. And number two, Ledley King.
I was actually going to, Ledley King's mine. I would put Ledley King as the greatest. And I'm glad to know that you'll be back supporting Spurs now that Jose's out.
I'm back now. I wore my shirt for the first time in a year, about 2 days ago. So.
But no, Phil, thank you very much for giving up your time. It's been wonderful speaking West Indies cricket with you and you sharing so much knowledge with us. It's been an absolute pleasure. So thank you very much.
No, thanks for having me on the show, man. It's been great.
No problem. Ladies and gentlemen, that has been episode 42. That has been the head coach of the West Indies, Uncle Phil Simmons. We hope you're rallying with us in a couple of weeks' time when the West Indies get to go head-to-head with South Africa and obviously then Australia and then Pakistan. Thank you for tuning in as ever. Stay locked onto all our particular channels. We've been the Caribbean Cricket Podcast in partnership with the CPL. Thank you and good night. We rule the cricket world.